One of the Democrats' constitutional experts arguing that President Trump should be impeached, apologizing now for invoking President Trump's 13-year-old son's name during today's hearing after she faced attacks for doing so. So here is Professor Pamela Carlin's initial comments and then her apology towards the end of the hearing.
Contrary to what President Trump has said, Article 2 does not give him the power to do anything he wants. And I'll just give you one example that shows you the difference between him and a king, which is the Constitution says there can be no titles of nobility. So while the president can name his son Baron, he can't make him a Baron. I want to apologize for what I said earlier about the president's son. It was wrong of me to do that. I wish the president would apologize, obviously, for the things that he's done that's wrong, but I do regret having said that.
Okay, that came after Carlin had faced a series of attacks for doing so from Republicans, the Trump campaign, and Melania Trump, who went on Twitter and said, a minor child deserves privacy and should be kept out of politics. Pamela Carlin, you should be ashamed of your very angry and obviously biased public pandering and using a child to do it. Everyone is back with me. Gloria, look, Professor Carlin's point, of course, that she was making was made extremely clearly by the examples she used, but she obviously did feel the need to apologize for that at the end of the hearing. It is extremely clear, though, with her performance in that hearing where she was completely unafraid, that Team Trump feels that she is a target now.
Oh, yeah, she is. Look, and she admits she made a mistake. She's not used to testifying. This this environment was not hospitable to what was kind of not a great joke. And, you know, she apologized for it only after Melania and, of course, the vice president himself also went after her. So, you know, she is a target. She's a liberal professor, and they tried to, well, who did you contribute to? And they tried to figure out who these people voted for as well. So she's kind of an easy target for them. And when you're not arguing the case itself, you're arguing the process, which they continued to argue all day. And then you were arguing about the witnesses, whom they felt were, you know, these eggheads from liberal elite institutions.
Right. All right. So to the point that Gloria just made, John, Republican Congressman Matt Gaetz also called out Professor Carlin for a series of donations she made to Democrats over the years. And let's just play that and then Carlin's defense.
Professor Carlin, you gave $2,000 or you gave $1,000 to Elizabeth Warren, right?
I believe so.
You gave $1,200 to Barack Obama?
I have no reason to question that.
And you gave $2,000 to Hillary Clinton?
That's correct.
Why so much more for Hillary than the other two?
Because I've been giving a lot of money to charity recently because of all of the poor people in the United States. I have a constitutional right under the First Amendment to give money to candidates. At the same time, we have a constitutional duty to keep foreigners from spending money in our elections. And those two things are two sides of the same coin.
Another witness, Michael Gerhardt, John, also confirmed his family donated to President Obama. And, of course, the Republican witness said he had voted against Trump. The question, though, John, remains, should Democrats have found witnesses who didn't provide this fodder, right, didn't have multiple $1,000 donations to Democratic candidates?
I don't know that that was necessary. I don't know that they even asked going in, who did you contribute to? Who did you vote for? This is information they could have found at the outset. What Matt Gaetz is doing is just really a sign of the times. He's a cheap shot artist, and he loves to do this. And he did it with aplomb. So it was expected, this sort of thing out of him. And it really cheapens the process. And that's what they want to do. They want to make this look like a much more unfair, less than partisan undertaking. And that's what he tried to accomplish with those questions.
Now, David, the top Republican on the Judiciary Committee also went after Professor Carlin and the other witnesses by suggesting, so it wasn't just, you know, whatever their donations might have been. It was also that they did not actually know what they were talking about. Let me play that.
No offense to our professors, but please, really? You couldn't have possibly actually digested the Adam Schiff report from yesterday or the Republican response in any real way?
And the one who fired back, David, was Professor Carlin. Here she is.
Mr. Collins, I would like to say to you, sir, that I read transcripts of every one of the witnesses who appeared in the live hearing, because I would not speak about these things without reviewing the facts. So I'm insulted by the suggestion that as a law professor, I don't care about those facts.
David, you know, look, she was unafraid to be combative. Was that effective?
Well, I thought that answer was very effective, and I thought that she signaled from the start that she was not going to be cowed by those kind of tactics. The joke was unfortunate, something that, you know, when you're a professor, you can make sort of tasteless or bad jokes in the classroom, and the students have to laugh. But it shouldn't have happened there, and she was right to apologize, and frankly, she deserved the criticism she got. But on that point, she was absolutely, you know, they were there, they're esteemed scholars. She clearly had done her homework, and she wasn't going to get pushed around. I thought that was very effective. But John's point is very important. The Republican strategy from the beginning is to depict this as a partisan scrum, as politics as usual, and take it out of the realm of something extraordinary and just fit it into the rubric of Washington politics. So what Gates did was very much in keeping with that, as were many of the other questions that were asked.
Right. And, Gloria, I guess the question is, how effective were Republicans at trying to cheapen the whole process?
Well, I think they did cheapen the process to a degree. I think that we learned a lot, however, in this hearing about the Constitution, about what the framers had in mind when they were talking about high crimes and misdemeanors, and about what the articles of impeachment, quite honestly, are likely to be, which are going to be abuse of power, bribery, obstruction of Congress, obstruction of justice. So try as they did to kind of make this just a discussion about process and other things, what we learned from these constitutional scholars, I think, was very important for the American public. Whether that breaks through, probably not. To a degree, I think people are probably set. Is this going to change any votes? I don't think so. But it was a hearing that the Judiciary Committee ought to have.
Yeah, we did. We did. As a country, whether you cared or whether it moved your view is almost beside the point.
Yeah.
You did need to hear from people who truly know about this and know about the Constitution.